Alright. That's sensors. Tactical. Phasers. Shipboard phasers. My god, phaser operation. The ship's main phasers are rated as Type X. The largest emitters, or maybe Type 10, the largest emitters available for starship use. Individual emitter segments are capable of directing 5.1 megawatts. There are 12 phaser arrays in two sizes located on both dorsal and ventral surfaces, as well as two arrays for lateral coverage. The maximum effective tactical range of the ship's phasers is 300,000 kilometers. Phasers provide little tactical benefit at warp velocities. Activation sequence. The first stage of the array segment, the Electroplasma System, or EPS, Submaster Flow Regulator, controls the energetic plasma which powers the phaser array through a series of physical irises and magnetic switching gates. This is the principal mechanism for controlling power phaser levels for firing. The flow regulator leads into the Plasma Distribution Manifold, or PDM, a secondary computer-controlled valving device which branches into supply conduits to feed each of the 200 pre-fire chambers. Within each pre-fire chamber, the plasma energy undergoes the rapid nadion effect. The final discharge stage is constituted by a trifaceted crystal formed from LICU-518 for each segment. Energy from all discharge segments converges on the release point where the phaser beam emerges and travels at the speed of light to the target. Narrow beams are created by rapid segment order firing. Wider fan or cone beams result from slower firing rates. So I looked at this and that. Okay. Personal phasers. Power settings. Power setting 1. Discharge energy index 15.75 for 0.25 seconds, damage index 0. Calibrated for base humanoid physiology, causes temporary central nervous system CNS impairment. Subjects remain unconscious for up to 5 minutes. Repeated long exposures result in higher levels of reversible CNS damage. 2. Medium stun. Discharge energy 45.3 for 0.75 seconds. Damage index 0. Base type humanoids are rendered unconscious for up to 15 minutes. Resistant humanoids for up to 5 minutes. Prolonged exposure results in low-level irreversible CNS and epithelial damage. Power setting 2. You know, I'm not going to read the discharge energy 0 and stuff. I'm going to just gonna skip that. You guys can read it if you want. Heavy stun. Base humanoids remain in a sleep state for about 1 hour. 15 minutes for resistant bioforms. Structural samples undergo significant thermal radiation. Setting 4. Thermal effects. You know, base humanoids undergo extensive CNS damage and epidermal EM trauma. Structural materials show visible thermal shock. Discharges of longer than 5 seconds produce deep heat storage effects within metal alloys. Setting 5. Humanoid tissue experiences severe burn effects, but deep layers will not char due to water content. Basic personnel. Force fields are penetrated after 5 seconds. Setting 6. Organic and structural materials show comparable penetration and molecular damage as higher energies cause rapid dissociation. Familiar thermal effects start decreasing at this level. Setting 7. Disruption effects are widespread and organic tissue damage causes immediate cessation of life processes. Setting 8. Humanoid organisms are vaporized due to cascading disruption effects. All protected matter is affected and penetrated. Setting 9. medium alloy or ceramic structural materials more than 100 centimeters thick exhibit energy rebound before vaporization. Setting 10. Heavy alloy structural material absorbs or rebounds energy for 0.55 seconds before vaporizing. Setting 11. Ultra-dense alloy structural materials absorb or rebound energy for 0.2 seconds before vaporizing. 12. Ultra-dense alloy structural material absorbs or rebounds energy for 0.1 seconds before vaporizing. Explosive disruption effects. Shielded matter exhibits minor vibrational heating. 14. Shielded matter shows medium vibrational heating effects. 15. Major vibrational heating effects. 16. Shielded matter exhibits light mechanical fracturing damage. And that's it. Phaser operation. Phasers, the primary defensive arms carried by Starfleet personnel, convert stored energy into tightly controlled beams. A replenishable cerium acrylide cell stores energy at a maximum of 1,300,000 megajoules per cubic centimeter, leaking no more than 1.05 kilojoules per hour. Cell charging is done aboard ship through power taps of electroplasma system, and in the field through portable bulk cerium acrylide units. Downstream from the cell are three interconnected control modules: the beam control assembly, safety interlock, and subspace transceiver assembly. Power settings are rated by a ratio of simple electromagnetic effects, SEM, to nuclear disruption force, NDF, at low to moderate settings. NDF is not applicable, limiting effects to stun and thermal impact from SEM. Type 1. The Type 1 cerium acrylide power cell holds 7,200,000 megajoules and has only one pre-fire chamber. It is only capable of power settings 1 through 8. Type 2. The Type 2 phaser cerium acrylide power cell holds 45 million megajoules and has four pre-fire chambers. Of similar construction to Type 1 phasers, but is much stronger and able to achieve power settings 1 to 16. Settings 9 through 16 employ high proportions of nuclear disruption energy. And a Type 3 phaser. Type 3 phaser rifles are special purpose instruments not included in a ship's normal inventory. It is able to attain power settings 1 to 16, but has a 15% greater power reserve than Type 2 phasers. Phaser theory. Phasers were developed to replace purely electromagnetic directed energy devices such as the laser and provide the lead defensive systems for Starfleet vessels. The term derives from phased energy rectification, referring to the original process which converted stored energy to directed energy. Phaser energy is released through application of the rapid nadion effect, RNE. Rapid nadions are short-lived subatomic particles possessing special properties, including the ability to liberate strong nuclear forces within the Fushigi no Umi class of superconducting crystals. Okay, whatever you say there, guy. Photon torpedoes. Torpedo configuration. The elliptical molded gamma expanding duranium tube has a plasma bonded terminium outer skin casing. Does it now? The complete torpedo casing weighs 247.5 kilograms. Phaser cuttings in the casing allow for warhead reactant loading, propulsion system exhaust grills, and hardline optical data network connections. The torpedo contains deuterium and anti-deuterium holding tanks, a central combiner tank, magnetic suspension components, target acquisition, guidance, and detonation assemblies, and a warp sustainer engine. Torpedo launcher tubes. The firing of torpedoes occurs in the launcher tubes, one forward within the connecting dorsal on deck 25, the other aft above the support pylon wing on deck 35. The four loader stages inject manti... See what I'm... I keep saying it. Inject matter, antimatter fuels into four torpedoes at a time and place... four torpedoes at a time and place them into the launcher for volley firing. Launcher tubes have sequential field induction coils and launch assist gas generators, providing inertial power. After firing, coil charges are neutralized and flash sterilizers clean the launch tubes of residues. Up to 10 torpedoes can be launched from each tube at one time. Torpedoes are used against targets at ranges of between 15 and about 3,500,000 kilometers. Personal phasers. Okay, we've seen all this. Deflector shields. Deflector system. The tactical deflector system is the primary defensive system of the Enterprise. It is a series of powerful deflector shields that protects the ship from natural and artificial hazards. As a force field device, the deflector system generates a localized zone of highly focused spatial distortion within which an energetic graviton field is maintained. The field closely follows the form of the ship and is emitted by a series of transmission grids on the vessel exterior. The field is highly resistant to impact due to mechanical incursions ranging from relativistic subatomic particles to more massive objects at lesser velocities. The deflector is also effective against a wide range of electromagnetic, nuclear, and other radiated and field energies. Alright. Field generators. The deflector system uses one or more graviton polarity source generators which produce phase-synchronized output through a series of subspace field distortion amplifiers. Primary hull flux energy is provided by 5 field generators on deck 10. 3 more generators are located on deck 31 in the secondary hull. 2 more generators are located in each warp nacelle. Each generator has 12 32 megawatts graviton polarity sources feeding 2 625 millicochrane subspace field distortion amplifiers. Cruise mode operation requires 1 active generator in each section at all times, with at least one unit available for activation should an alert condition arise. Operation Impact. Raising shields to defensive configuration results in a number of special operating procedures. Sensors suffer from a substantially reduced data collection rate, and their use must be strictly prioritized. Most defensive strategy requires silent running mode, permitting only passive sensors to be used. The transporter system is unable to transport through the shields due to insufficient bandwidth and the shield's spatial distortion effects disrupting the transporter beam pattern integrity. Warp fields are also affected by the shield's spatial distortion, but this is usually catered for by the warp drive's control software. Battle bridge, we've seen. Be sure I've read that. Tactical policies. A starship represents the United Federation of Planets and its member nations. Officers and crew must anticipate and avoid potential conflicts. All options must be exhausted before using force. First contact requires cultural and technological assessment even during combat situations. Starships are rarely permitted to fire first against any threat. Okay, life support. Atmospheric system. This system maintains a Class M compatible nitrogen-oxygen atmosphere throughout the habitable volume of the Enterprise. 2 independent primary atmospheric plenum systems deliver temperature and humidity-controlled environmental gases throughout the ship. A separate reserve system and emergency systems provide additional redundancy. Nominal atmospheric values for Class M compatible conditions are 26 degrees Celsius and 45% relative humidity at a pressure of 101 kilopascals. Atmospheric composition is maintained at 78% nitrogen, 21% oxygen, and 1% trace gases. About 10% of living accommodations can be converted to Class H, K, or L environmental conditions without major swap out. Class N and N2 conditions are possible in an additional 2% of living quarters. Emergency support systems. Emergency systems provide suitable life support for the crew for sufficient periods of time for engineering staff to restore normal function to the primary or reserve system. The contingency atmospheric and power supply system supplements the two redundant primary atmospheric support system and reserve backup system. It consists of 425 self-contained air supply and power nodules, or modules, actually, located throughout the ship. These units allow about 30 minutes of atmosphere and lighting in the event of a total failure of all primary and reserve systems. In addition, the vessel has 52 emergency shelters designed to hold up to 65 crew members for 36 hours. They are equipped with emergency breathing gas, water, food, power for 24 hours, and at least two emergency pressure garment (EPG) environment suits. Waste management. The Enterprise consists of a closed ecological system for recycling waste material. Without this process, the ship would be unable to carry sufficient food and water for extended voyages. Environmental support complexes on Deck 6, 13, and 24 house waste water treatment and recycling units. Decks 9, 13, and 34 house the solid waste processing units. About 82% of all solid waste is sterilized and recycled. Material that cannot be directly recycled by mechanical or chemical means is stored for matter synthesis recycling. The waste is dematerialized and then rematerialized into desirable objects. An auxiliary spacecraft. Shuttlecraft types. Type 15. Production base. Starbase 134 Integration Facility, Rigel 6. Type is a light, short-range sublight shuttle. Accommodation 2. Pilot and systems manager. Power plant, 2 500 millicochrane impulse driver engines, 8 DEFL 657 hot gas RCS thrusters, and 3 cerium crellide storage cells. I'm not going to read all this crap. Armament has 2 Type 4 phaser emitters. Drink. Type 15A. Again, on Rigel 6, light, short-range sublight shuttle. Accommodation, again, is 2. I'm not going to read this. Armament, 2 Type 4 phaser emitters. Type 16. Rigel 6, medium, short-range sublight shuttle. Accommodation is 2 again. Type 4 phaser emitters, 2 of them. Personnel shuttle type 6. Production base, ASDB Integration Facility, Utopia Planitia Yards, Mars. Type, light short-range warp shuttle. Accommodation, 2 flight crew. Passenger configurations, 6 standard, 2 diplomatic. Performance, warp 1.2 for 48 hours, standard, warp 2 for 36 hours, uprated. Armament is none for standard and 2 Type 4 phaser emitters for special operations. Personnel shuttle type 7. Same Utopia Planitia Yards, medium short range warp shuttle. 2 flight crew, passenger configuration 6 standard, 2 diplomatic. performance, warp 1.75 for 48 hours standard, warp 2 for 36 hours uprated. Armament is none for standard and two type 5 phaser emitters for special operations. And cargo shuttle type 9A. Still on Mars, heavy long-range warp shuttle. Accommodation, 2 flight crew, 1 cargo specialist. All this crap. Performance is warp 2 for 36 hours standard, warp 2.2 for 32 hours uprated. Armament is none for standard, 2 type 5 phaser emitters for special operations. Shuttlecraft operations. The Enterprise is equipped with auxiliary shuttlecraft to support mission objectives. The standard complement of shuttlecraft includes 10 standard personnel shuttles, 10 cargo shuttles, and 5 special purpose craft. 12 two-person shuttle pods are carried for short range and extra vehicular use. Of that many shuttlecraft, really? For some reason I thought there was only like 2 of them or something. Cruise mode operation requires 1 standard shuttlecraft and 1 shuttle pod to be at urgent standby at all times, available for launch at 5 minutes notice. Shuttle bays. The Enterprise has 3 major facilities intended for the support of auxiliary shuttlecraft operations from the ship. The main shuttle bay, located in the center and aft sections on Deck 4, in the primary hull, includes launch support, recovery, and maintenance facilities for shuttle operations. 2 additional secondary shuttle bays are located in the center and aft sections, both port and starboard, of Deck 13 in the dorsal area of the secondary hull. My God. We're done with systems. This is Enterprise. So I've got mission. As a Galaxy-class starship, the Enterprise is able to operate free of starbase refurbishment for extended periods and has the ability to execute deep space exploration missions, including charting and mapping, first cultural contact scenarios, and full biologic and ecologic studies. Just blank space. Okay, now we got the mission log. Oh! Haha. That's for loading and saving the game. Which it failed because I've actually never saved that way. Delete! So my God. Almost 2 hours. Who'd think I'd do 2 hours of reading in a Sega Genesis Mega Drive game? That's crazy. I'm wondering if there's any other game like this that has 2 hours of straight reading that you can do. At least, you know, I mean, if you read it, you know, not out loud, it would be a lot quicker, but that's a lot of reading for a console game from the 90s, you know? With third generation console. So anyway, thanks for watching. Stay tuned for next episode when we actually, return to the sanatorium or whatever the hell, and get back into the story. Thanks for watching. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.